questions that we talked about. So.
Cool. So we'll just start with going down the line and introducing ourselves and what we do and what brings us here. So Katie, why don't you start?
Hey, so my name is Katie TWYMAN. I am co-executive director of an organization called Uplift. We are a nonprofit that's dedicated to combating sexual violence and emotional manipulation in online communities specifically through education and advocacy. So we just started in 2014 after a series of allegations of sexual abuse, emotional manipulation, all sorts of really gross stuff. Happened within the YouTube community, and here we are a year later. Really excited to make some positive change.
Woo! Woo.
Yeah.
Such worthy thing. I just love that your organization exists. I'm so proud that it has actually happened. I'm Jackson Bird. I'm the communications director at the Harry Potter Alliance. Who here knows the Harry Potter Alliance? Yeah. Oh, yeah. All right. Uninitiated, and as a refresher for the rest of you, the Harry Potter Alliance is a nonprofit that turns fans into heroes. So basically, we use the power of story as well as the intrinsic enthusiasm and community spirit and creativity of fans to mobilize them towards social action. So we've been around for 10 years. Next year will be our 11th birthday, so I think we're going to get a Hogwarts letter then. We actually wizards. We've got over 250 organized chapters in 30 nations on 6 continents, and for the decade that we've been around, we've done everything from funding the protection of civilians in Darfur and Burma to collecting and donating over 250,000 books and building libraries around the world. We also register first-time voters, we work on LGBTQIA issues, economic inequality, net neutrality, mental health, bullying, all sorts of things. Most recently, we actually negotiated with Warner Brothers to make all Harry Potter licensed chocolate fair trade. And as far as YouTube goes, we have a YouTube channel that I produce. I star on our channel as Harry Potter, the boy who vlogged. And in my spare time, I use that word like lightly, weirdly, not really spare time, I also have a channel called Will It Waffle.
Will Waffle!
Thank you.
Awesome. Hey guys, my name is Seth Maxwell. I'm the founder and CEO of The Fish Project. There are lots of amazing water orgs in the world. We're definitely not the biggest and definitely not the oldest, but we're without question the world's leading youth water activism organization. So we've got about 300 chapters across primarily North America with students in middle school, high school, and college who we educate about the global water crisis and then provide them with campaigns and tools to actually take tangible action to end the water crisis. And so this small army of students do, you know, dances for water, video game tournaments for water, walks for water, and we commit to give 100% of all the funds they raise directly to funding projects on the ground. And so it's been an exciting sort of 6-year journey since we started as a group of Southern California kids here trying to end the water crisis. But it's been amazing, and as we sort of grew up ourselves as an organization, I think we sort of grew alongside, similar to you guys, you know, just with the YouTube and online community. And so our audience, our you know, members, our fans, that's who they are. It's just the similar sort of crossover there. So it's been exciting to see how we've been able to work together within the community alongside you know, everyone from fans to influencers to really make significant change.
My name is Lauren Fairweather. I'm a YouTube content creator. I have a channel called Lauren Fairweather. And on my channel, I do a wide variety of things, and I've struggled for a long time to explain to people exactly what it is I do. And the thing that I have narrowed it down to is two things. I'm very excited about everything I make a video about. So whether I'm excited about a book and I want to talk about it, or I'm excited about a craft project and I want to make it and teach people how to make it, I just am really enthusiastic about everything I post about. Really just, my channel is a place for the things that I love, and the cool thing about that is that other people who love those things have been finding my videos and responding to that and really just engaging with me. And so my favorite thing about my YouTube channel is that when I post a video, the end game is not to get views, the end game is not to have people just see it and forget about it. I want them to take that video and think about it, and I always ask a question at the end that they can sort of start a conversation with, and then I go through, I post the video, and then I read the comments, and I spend like the next 12 hours just talking to people and having a conversation about the topic I started in my video. And so engagement is very important to me. It's one of my favorite things about the platform. And I think that it makes this community a lot richer, and I think it's a really important thing that more YouTube creators should focus on.
Yeah. Woo!
And so that's kind of what we're going to be talking about in this panel today. You know, three of us are from nonprofits, and so a part of what we want to be talking about is, you know, how can you take your YouTube experience and do a little bit more with it and participate in larger ways. But we also kind of want to talk more just within your YouTube experience. Like Lauren was saying, how the experience doesn't end when you hit upload, and how you can really make it the two-way street that YouTube is, and why it's a great platform for that.
So many creators on YouTube are also fans of other YouTube channels. You're not just a creator or just a fan. A lot of people overlap that. And so I think it's important to not just engage with your own audience, but to go join other audiences, engage with theirs, and talk to other creators. And that's what makes the community really rich and beautiful. Since this is a workshop, we wanted to get you guys as involved as you would like to be. We figured we'd try a few different ways to kind of allow you guys to have discussions about different topics related to this. How did you want to start this?
So what we were thinking was maybe we've got a couple of sort of jumping off discussion kind of questions and topics, and so we were thinking we would do a question and we'll kind of discuss a little and then open the floor for questions, and then we'll go on to a next main topic question and do this the same format.
A little bit more collaborative than just sitting here and watching us talk for 45 minutes and then having you guys talk for 15, so.
Yeah, totally. And so we have you two have mics. Awesome. So you want me to kick off?
You want to ask questions? Actually, the one in the middle after the gaps.
Okay, cool. So so we'll start. Each of you can kind of jump in with what you think. So the first question is just, how can fans get more involved and engaged with creators and causes?
One thing I didn't mention in my kind of description of myself is that I'm a giant nerd. So aside from my kind of nonprofit background, really the way I became involved in the YouTube community specifically is through the comments. And really beyond that, just reaching out, not just to the creators, but to the other people who are viewing this stuff. I feel like that's something that I see happening a lot, is that especially with some of the larger name YouTubers, when they have viewers, the people who are viewing their videos focus on contacting the people who are uploading the videos, when really there's so much richness and diversity and difference of thought within the comments and within the other people in the audience. The people that I've met, including Jack and Lauren, in my time just kind of talking about my views after the end of a video are the things that led me to start a nonprofit in the first place, to be perfectly frank. I think there's so much value to communicating with one another in a whole variety of ways, whether it's in the comments on Twitter, making video responses, which are a little bit more complicated than it used to be. but really, that's what's worked for me more than anything, is just the beauty of conversation.
Yeah, and you know, I think the community that you first got started in, Katie, is actually kind of the hallmark example of like participatory comments in a positive section, which is Nerdfighters. Katie did not mention that.
Yeah.
Katie is one of the original founders of, I believe, of FEI Nerdfighters.
It's true.
which is old FEI, one of the old FEI Tumblrs. And so they've kind of become basically the community organizers of the Nerdfighter community now.
Yeah, and what I can kind of say is, honestly, I managed to get to know John and Hank and so many of my closest friends just by participating in different activities afterwards. So even if it's something, Lauren, you mentioned having, questions that you put at the end of the video, but I guess I would challenge you guys to think about things that aren't prompted by the creators. We're all really brilliant and creative people, and I mean, even if you aren't the one making the video, there's still a lot that you can do. So things like starting a Tumblr. My friends and I just noticed that there wasn't a Tumblr that kind of was a middle ground for people to post Nerdfighter things that they liked. A lot of it was art, a lot of it was featuring other projects that people were working on, and eventually John and Hank recognized it and it turned into a much bigger thing than we anticipated it to be, so.
I think it's interesting like, to sort of popcorn off of that and sort of look at either if you guys are creators or if you're fans and you're engaging in conversation with the content that another creator who you're a fan of has created. I mean, sharing the things that are important to you and passionate to you in those conversations, whether they're in comments or other outlets, whether on Tumblr, etc. The creator, you know, when you watch people who watch your videos and see what they're talking about and see what they care about, you respond based off of what your audience wants. And the same thing's true for other creators that you care about or for you, right? And so I would encourage you, if you are a creator, to curate that. But also, you know, for you as a fan or to encourage your fans to have that conversation and share with you, like, what is it that breaks your heart? What is it that you care about so that you can then, in turn, respond and curate your content around how to then, you know, better provide those opportunities to organize your community and your fans to take action against those things or for those things and really make impact. Because really, I mean, everything that happens in that online community really is an extension of what happens in the offline community. It's the things you care about. And so I think figuring out, you know, what is it that breaks your heart and sharing it with the communities that you're a part of and vice versa, inviting those fans that are members of your community and your content to share that with you so that you can help, you know, frame and shape those discussions and see what you can do to take that offline and make impact. Because really, even the largest, you know, influencer or creator is really only as powerful as his or her audience. And it's really that that gives them that ability. And so they can't make the impact they make without that army of people who say, okay, we care about these things, we're going to take action this way. And so I think it's really a two-way street. I would say, you know, for you as a creator to ask those questions, invite people to be a part of that conversation, and then for you as a fan to inject yourself and share what you care about in those conversations with the people who you love as well.
Another really cool thing is that there are so many different options right now for ways to engage with people. You can leave a comment on something. This isn't a built-in feature anymore, but it's something that I still try to keep doing is video responses. You could, if you are feeling so fired up that you can type in your comment for a half an hour and you realize it's really long, you think, oh, okay, maybe this should be a whole video. And then there are also people who, you know, will make some kind of art-inspired quote by whatever you've done and post it on Tumblr or Instagram or Twitter. And so whatever way that you love to express yourself, there are so many different forms of media and places online where you can share those things. And so it's not just a textual conversation. It can become visual, it can become creative, and it can be something more than what it was when the original creator posted the video that sparked that discussion.
Oh yeah, I mean we talk about this a lot with the Harry Potter lines. We're doing a campaign on fair use right now, specifically with regards to like fan works, like fan art and fan fiction. One of the things that we talk about is how it, I think a lot of corporations and stuff are scared that, and sometimes like creators and authors too are scared that fan fiction and fan art is harming their work because it's like changing what their original intent was or something. But you know, we like to say they're transformative works. They're adding to it. They're making the experience and the community so much better by adding those. And it's the same thing for anything on YouTube as a creator or a fan. Like it's just adding to it. I love seeing when people like make waffle art. It's so cool.
I did that.
Yeah, we made it together. And Ken actually came up to me at Comic-Con and had made one that we did. But I think, if anyone in the audience has things that they want to add, like their own insights on this or any questions, go ahead and raise your hand and we've got mics that we can hand to you.
Or if you are a creator, what are ways that you kind of get your fans involved, get your audience to be part of the conversation? How can you facilitate more engagement in addition to participating in it? Yeah, Paul?
As a creator, something that I discovered early on is that the comments that I would get on my videos were usually specifically about what I talked about, because my presentation was literally just that. I'd say, here's what I'm going to talk about it for 5 minutes, thank you for watching, please subscribe and like. And I didn't like that level, so I changed my outro, I changed it to tell me anything that matters to you in the comments, because I want to know what matters to you. And then I started engaging a lot more with people who would find me on Twitter. And then I started, I would see those people, I would connect with them on Twitter, and I would see what they posted on Tumblr. And I would respond to them that way. And all of a sudden, my tiny little subscriber base of like 500 people almost tripled in a year. And I got a big network of people talking to me now. And it's weird. Some people recognize me here. It's weird. So that's what that was my approach. That was just trying to take it to lots more platforms and really encouraging not just a response to my immediate post, but to anything.
Yeah, and you know, going off the back of that, you don't need to think like, I mean, I think all of you have creator badges. You're all owning the fact that you are creators here. Even if you're not making videos, if you're commenting, you are part of the experience and you are a creator. And one of the great things about YouTube, and I think specifically a lot of us in here probably have this kind of mindset of you don't need to have like huge numbers or anything to like start being a part of what we're talking about. I mean, I love YouTube because even if you have, you know, 25, 100 subscribers, people are still finding your videos and they're still commenting and you can still like engage with them in so many ways and have great discussions like Paul was talking about. So yeah, totally. Okay.
So I have a question. There are ways to engage with people and get them to take action, but a lot of what's going to matter is if they take pro action, that they get in on the ground floor and do stuff before all of a sudden it's a law. You know, I find a lot of stuff on social media, people will talk about, oh, this thing that just happened in Congress or what have you, I'm so mad about it, how could it have gotten so far and become the law of the land? How do you make content around an idea that is yet to be law, but you need to take proaction before it goes the way you don't want it to? Because a lot of people don't even know how to contact their representative or take action. There are a lot of, you have organizations that deal with the lasting effect and the continuance of an idea. How do you get like pinpoint specific ways to take proaction?
Yeah, I mean that was a lot of what we do at the Harry Potter Alliance. Is we're making, you know, advocacy and activism and just responsible citizenship accessible for young people or you know, not even young people, but just, you know, people who haven't done it before. So like when we have things where we want to contact a representative, we actually make our own form, like a standalone web page, and we write it in the language of fans, whatever fandom we're engaging at the time, and we make it easy to understand the issues, and then it's like a very simple instructions on how to do that. And also, you know, another thing that we've done, when we used to do phone banking a lot, we would actually run Hangouts, or well, that now they were Hangouts. At the time, they were Ustream and Livestream. But we would run those for whatever hours we were phone banking, and so we would be online, or we'd have people in the chat just like instructing on how to do it and encouraging people and being like, you can do it. Like, you might have social anxiety and you don't like calling, like phone calling, but like, here's how to get over that. And here, you know, we believe in you and we're cheering you on. But in terms of, you know, you were talking about like the long haul of like how to get people to care about these things before there's even like legislation on the table. I mean, that's just a lot of encouraging the discussion and continuing to talk about it and making it a way for people, you know, packaging it in a way that people are interested in it.
Yeah, it's kind of like meeting people where they're at. I actually was part of those live streams that you're talking about with the filmmaking. and I remember like with the Harry Potter Alliance, obviously is the Harry Potter Alliance, so they had house points and things like that that made sense to young people. And also, I mean, I personally am a competitive spaz, so that was interesting to me. but it really is a matter of identifying what, not just what issues are important to your audience, but also how they think about the world in general. So if people are looking at things through the lens of, you know, nerd fighters or something we brought up, or the different fandoms or something like that, then framing things in a way that kind of suits that makes it feel more approachable is what I've found in a lot of ways. Especially with the issue of sexual violence, I mean, it's not a cute subject. It's not one that people are super excited to talk about. But in the same vein, you're not going to be able to do anything about these issues unless you have the conversations. So one thing that we've found really helpful is modeling the conversation, and also kind of breaking it down into smaller steps and smaller pieces that seem a little less intimidating, like just making a video on one simple subject instead of saying, okay, let's have a big conversation on sexual assault. Go. Because that's too much. That's too much for a lot of people to handle. So
I feel like a lot of times you can feel intimidating to think through the lens of, okay, well, I've got this audience, right? You're all creators, or even if you're not, you're a fan of other creators, and you're looking at how do I inject myself into the conversation of the community of that fandom and do something meaningful offline. It can feel a little intimidating to think through the lens of, well, like, maybe you don't feel like I'm an expert on this issue that I care about, but you still care about it. And I think that sometimes we can get hung up a lot of times on, like, well, if I only had X, Y, Z thing, if I was only a little more educated on this issue, if I only had a little more money, or if I only had a little more, you know, whatever it is, then I would be the one to sort of start this or take action. And I would just encourage you guys, the same thing we encourage all of our students if there's practice, like the phone doesn't ring. Like, the phone never rings. Like, the phone didn't ring for John and Hank. Like, they didn't, like, no one called them and said, hey, will you start, like, their criteria? They just did it. And the reality is, like, it won't ring for you either. So if you're waiting for someone else to be the person to frame and shape, like, whatever the next movement is about the issues that you care about and try to engage the fandom that you're a part of to do it, it's not going to happen. The world needs you to be that person. And so what I would encourage you is, like, take the time. Like, if you don't know how to go about finding a representative, call, like, do the research, and then create it in the comment section of whatever fandom you're part of, or create it in your own video. I think it can feel a little intimidating too to think, well, do I have to make, like, my entire channel about, like, this social cause thing? I think, again, like, not to just, like, ring the John and Hank bell, but they do a great job of, like, balancing. They do, like, they do an amazing job of balancing all the things they care about, as well as just really crazy, silly stuff. And it's
thinking,
like,
about bats, you know.
And it doesn't mean that you have to just become this, like, person on a soapbox on the side of the street corner with a megaphone, like, all you do is talk about that. But I would encourage you, like, this is an incredible intersection, this community of all of these different people with such a crazy diverse set of interests and passions and things that you can do. And I would say, step up. Like, whether it's in the comment section, whether it's in your own video, or whether it's in trying to organize something offline from that community, like, the world is hurting in so many ways and needs you. And so I would say, go find the information about what's happening before it's a law, and say, hey, you may not feel like your voice is huge, but I promise you, like, if you look around, if there's any more proof that it is, like, look around this event. Like, you are a part of this very collective, powerful group, and without you, and if everyone sort of walked away because they felt that way, then there would be nothing here. And so I would say, be that person. Go research it, go find it out, and then find the places that you want to inject yourself into the conversation, and you'd be amazed at what happened.
You can also, in general, find your people. Use the internet as a tool to find other people who are passionate about those things and whose voice maybe may not be amplified enough to really be able to reach a large amount of people. So, you know, if you were really passionate about something but you don't quite know where to start, look for somebody else who's passionate about it too. Join forces with them. Even telling somebody who made a video about some social cause they believe in that you believe in it too can have a huge impact.
So how do you balance authentic audience engagement with content creation? And spending enough time to make the content good to further a cause, while at the same time committing to the engagement that's going to further the cause that you're trying to entertain or.
I think like paying attention to your audience and that engagement and stuff can drive your content and the production of it. And I don't think that, especially these days on YouTube, like high quality production level means that you're not authentic. I think, you know, being authentic is that engagement with your fans, you know, viewers, like what they care about and what they're saying and interacting with them. That's really cool.
No, I mean, I would say in that same vein, like in the same way that we said at the beginning, that you watch what people say about your videos, you watch what people say about like whether they like it, they don't like it, what things they care about. The people who you care about, their content, are going to look at what you say. And so I would say, you know, you're going to naturally want to craft that content around who you are and who your audience is. And I think it's going to happen naturally. I don't think it's something you have to sort of force through a little tunnel. Like, I think it's just going to happen naturally as you continue to share who you are as a person and your fans respond to that. Authentically with who they are as people.
Yeah, people tend to respond to authenticity with authenticity. So the more kind of honest and open you are, I feel like the more honest and open your audience will be. And it really, that's where the relationship comes in. So I feel like people are, we're humans, we feed off of communication. I feel like people are going to respond to that above everything. So I feel like when you're talking about content creation, like Jeff was saying, that's a huge part of it.
As far as balancing time, I think it's just as important as the content I'm making. I think audience engagement is just as important, so I will spend an equal amount of time. It's also kind of nice because I get a little tired of, you know, editing and waiting for the video to upload, so once it's up, like, I get excited to talk in the comments. It's like a big switch, it switches the pace, and it, you know, keeps it interesting for me. So I will spend hours and hours on it, engaging with people, because it's just as important to me as the content I'm making.
Just adding to that, it's such a great opportunity for education of issues too, because a lot of viewers, I know for his channel, are 12, 13 year old kids, and they're like, what's the FCC? I don't even know what that is. And
I love the FCC video YouTube made, by the way. Oh, that was great.
So it's just such an awesome opportunity for education, and sometimes, you know, and then my daughter did one on the YouTube views, and they've come to realize, yes, they're going to step on their soapboxes every once in a while, because these are issues that the kids need to be educated about, because it's happening to the teens, you know? These predators and these issues affect them, you know? The internet is theirs. So it's a great opportunity to educate them.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and it's so cool to see, you know, young people making videos about that, but also, you know, in the comments, I get, oftentimes I might, like, see that I have a comment that says something, I'm like, I should kind of, like, respond. Maybe it's a question about what something means, or just, like, something I should kind of respond to, educating, and before I get a chance to, someone has already jumped in and done that, which is, like, so awesome to see, and then I'll see, you know, really long threads of them going back and forth, there's someone else jumping in, and everyone's kind of like educating each other and like sharing their information and experiences, and that is such an awesome thing.
I think we're all kind of in a constant state of learning. There really is no way to know everything in the whole world, especially when you're opening yourself up to a platform that has so many different kinds of people from so many kinds of different situations, places in the world, and races and everything like that. And so I think we're all learning, and it's a good place to ask questions. It's a good place to say, nobody's ever explained this to me before. What is the best way for me to respond in this kind of a situation? And I love when other people jump in and answer questions in my comment section, because it becomes a discussion. It's not just me talking to my fans and them talking back to me. It becomes a whole community. People get to know each other in my comments, and I love that so much. But yeah, it's so important. I'm constantly learning too. If I have said something in one of my videos, people will jump in and say, you know what, that's kind of problematic. A better way to phrase that would have been this, and this is why. And it's so important just for living in the world to think about things like that.
And on the spirit of being constantly like learning and stuff, the Wi-Fi password in here is learn everything.
Oh.
If you want to log on.
All right, so I have a question about drawing a fair balance between encouraging participation and engagement, and also then taking on the risk that comes with it. So ideally you would like to, well, be as open as possible, maybe even like open up your videos for collaboration and say, well, hey, do you want to be, if you, as a fan, bring some skill that you can use to probably make my video better, you can do that. Hopefully add some annotations, or maybe do some touching up, or add captions, or what have you. So that engages the fan community even more. But then at the same time, as a creator, you're kind of like opening yourself up to all kinds of risks. So how would you draw the line there?
Yeah, sorry, I keep jumping in.
Go for it.
You need to be cautious both for your own privacy and mental health, but then also, you know, as a creator, specifically if you're making, you know, content with a narrative or something, you know, on that side of it, I was actually just in a panel right now on the industry track, kind of like the opposite version of this panel, and, you know, we were talking about if, you know, fans are saying they don't like something and they want to see something, and it kind of goes against, like, what your vision of, you know, your narrative was going to be. Maybe you don't need to listen to exactly what they're saying, but maybe listen to why they're saying that, and like what the core of that is, like what are they not getting out of what you're giving them. So there's that, but from the you know, personal and privacy side, I would say set up those boundaries, and set them up before, like, even if you're not, you know, getting into YouTube to be famous or something, it could happen. Like, you never know when a video might go viral overnight. So, like, have those boundaries for yourself set in place. Take some time to think about what those are. Like, how much about your personal life are you going to share? And especially if your content is, like, your life, don't feel like you need to do everything that your viewers are saying. Or, like, you are a person, you grow and you change. And if people liked who you were as a persona when you were 17 and now you're 24 and, you know, you're a different person, don't feel the need to change. A good friend of mine actually is kind of the cautionary tale of this. In 2010, I think, Dan Brown, for those of you who know him, he did a project where every single day for a year he was going to do what his viewers told him to do. He lived his entire life. They had a whole system of like polls, and you know, he did have like management, kind of a company behind him helping him out. But like he literally was like moving across the country and like doing like huge scale things, and he had to stop the project after a couple of months because it actually just wasn't totally disastrous, but it was not a healthy way to be living.
Also, don't be afraid to change those boundaries you set for yourself. Mm-hmm. If you find out through a bad experience that you've given out too much, I used to be on a collaborative channel called Five Awesome Girls, where me and four of my friends, people I knew, ranging from people I knew really well to people I didn't know so well and I was excited to get to know, we did a sort of Vlogbrothers-esque project where we would make videos back and forth to each other. We lived all over the country. We interacted for several years in a row through video. And for a long time, those videos were very personal. I was talking to them as if, you know, we're just friends, we're just interacting, talking to each other, like we're having a normal, friendly conversation, except all of a sudden, thousands and then tens of thousands of people were watching us. And by the end of that channel, people were starting to treat me like my life was a television show, like I was a character that was basically just there to entertain them. And if I had to make up drama to make it more interesting to them, they would prefer that to the way I was actually feeling. And that hurt me. We got a wide variety of responses to that channel, and in general, it seems like most people were growing up with us and then just seeing what we were going through and seeing the way we handled the things that were rough in our lives really affected a lot of people, and that's like the best thing that you can hope for when you're doing a project like that. But when that channel ended, I decided I need to draw more lines. I need to pull back, and my personal life cannot be the main thing I talk about on my channel anymore. I just don't. It was like every time I got a negative comment, it hurt me because they were talking about something that was too close to me. If somebody disagrees with my point of view I have about a book I've read, that's not so close to me. It's not like sharing that my grandfather has passed away and somebody's laughing at me crying on camera. That's too close. So I don't do that anymore, I learned. And sometimes it's hard when you change the rules for yourself a little bit, because then people feel like you've pulled back and they feel like you shared this before, why aren't you sharing it now? But I think it's important to do what you're most comfortable with, do what makes it feel like a healthy situation for you, and people will respond to that, because now I feel like my privacy is much more respected because I've treated it as something that's important to me, and it's important to my audience now too.
Yeah, and I feel like a part of it is also kind of discerning when to like straight up state what those boundaries are. Mm-hmm. As an anti-sexual violence organization, we do have times where people will disclose to us and say, hey, this just happened to me, or I was victimized when, or I'm still in this situation and it's a chronic problem. And we aren't a crisis center, period. So it's been an issue where we need to figure out a way to kind of comfort these people who are obviously going through something quite traumatic while still respecting our own boundaries, both for our sake as an organization and as individuals running an organization, and for the person who is reaching out to us. I mean, I'm sure all of us on here agree that we would never want to put ourselves in a position where we were trying to guide something through something when we weren't qualified to do that, and it ended poorly. So there is a time and a place where it's okay to say, I'm not qualified for that, or I'm not in a position to say that, or I'm not comfortable with that. That's something that also came up in this room a little earlier at the mental health on YouTube panel, that sometimes just through sharing some experiences, if you seem like you have gotten through it and kind of mastered that thing, or you figured out the solution to a certain problem, people will want you to be the person who gives them advice on it. Mm-hmm. And it's okay to say that you are not in a position to do that, whether it is just because of personal boundaries that you have, or because you're just straight up not qualified to give answers. So.
Yeah, I actually had a conversation with Hank Green about that recently. There are certain things that, like, you know, we have been through or overcome that we don't talk about, and a lot of people don't know that we've actually been through them because we had our own ways of how we got through them that are probably not helpful to tell other people, like, I just got over it eventually. Like, that doesn't help someone, and also we're in no way qualified to talk about it. But I actually think this transitions really good into another question that we kind of had prepared, which is, how do we make and facilitate positive and respectful contributions when engaging, even if we disagree with something?
Oh boy. That is the question, isn't it? I mean, this is something that happens outside of YouTube all the time too. Like, by no means is this specific to online interactions. So I feel like the publicity of like a video or an online campaign or something adds this really weird component.
Yeah.
Like if you have different political views than your grandma and you're in your family room, like that's a different ballgame than having someone make a video about why your campaign sucks and why you're totally wrong.
That has happened to you?
Not quite, but I have seen it happen to other people. Well, we've had a few times when people have said that. Not in videos so much, but in other frameworks that we were going through things the wrong way. And early on in the game, there were a lot of people who, when we were given public support by some larger name YouTubers, that we were kind of selling out, and that, oh, we thought that you guys were going to be some, you know, grassroots solution, and now obviously you're just in the hands of these bigger YouTubers and it's not gonna do anything. And that pretty much what we did in that situation was just complain to it to each other because we needed to get it out of our systems and then move on with our lives because we knew that what we were doing was important.
That is a good practical tip that I think Lacey was the one who shared it in the Women on YouTube panel yesterday of you know, if you are at that point where you're getting negative comments or things that you disagree with and you don't necessarily want to interact with them, or even if you do interact with them, have someone in your life, like in your real life, that you can talk to about it, you know, a roommate or a spouse or a sibling. And you need someone to vent to for your own mental health.
No, I mean, it's interesting. Even if you have something that you really care about that you feel like is the least political, the least, you know, like, it seems to me like, you know, obviously I'm biased, so I fully acknowledge my bias. But I feel like, you know, like, I'm like water. Like, everyone needs water. Like, it's not a religious thing.
How dare you?
It's not a political issue. It's not, you know, but yet there's still, you know, a lot of times people will come, whether it's on YouTube videos you post, whether it's on, you know, comment sections on our community section on our site, like whatever it is, we have people interact and say, well, like, you know, do you think it's my responsibility as an American or as a Canadian or as a, you know, as a British person to provide XYZ for someone else? And a lot of times for me, it can be really frustrating. I'm sure you know in the way you guys have those internal conversations where you like get frustrated and talk to each other. It's like, I don't understand how people don't see this. Like, it's not about America's responsibility to provide water for someone else in another country. It's, if I really believe that water is a human right, then I believe that it is every human's responsibility to provide every human with safe water. And that's a very different conversation than, is it my job as an American to provide a certain lifestyle for someone else? And so it's, but it really does come down to, I think for us, there are like stages of response, right? There's the like internal response. It's like me going to my staff and I'm like, WTF, like, we're the like, these people are crazy. And then, like, okay, like, let's draft a response, and then, like, let's make sure we're reading appropriate and, you know, compassionate and understanding, while also trying to take that as an opportunity to educate in a loving way and in a respectful way, and understanding that we may not win people over, and that's okay. Like, you don't have to win everybody over, but you're never going to. And so I think it's just a matter of figuring out, you know, what are the appropriate stages for you of response, both internal and external, and how do you A, manage your own process of being okay with it, and B, then determine what you're going to put out there in the world?
It's also from the other side of things. If you see another creator doing something that you disagree with and you feel like you need to speak up to them about what they've done, or if they've said something to offend you or something like that, this is something I have a really hard time doing, because I know it's like a topic that people get fired up about usually when something like that happens. And I know that even if I have a million smiley faces and hearts and things like that, and trying to communicate, I'm not angry with you, I just want to share my opinion, I just want to let you know that I disagree and maybe we can all learn something from this, I know they're going to read it in that, why did you just have that voice? That, you know, is in your head when you get a comment that disagrees with you. And so I think at least in text format, it's hard to, like, even no matter how respectful I feel like it reads when I'm reading it, I'm reading it in like the quietest, gentlest, sweetest voice possible. Anybody who knows me would know this voice. It's like, I'm really sorry, but it made me really uncomfortable when you did that. But then somebody else is going to read it, and they may put that angry voice on it, and I don't want to. It's hard to. I think there are definitely situations where anger is an entirely appropriate response, especially if someone's not really listening, and you need to let them know that what they've done is harmful. But I tend to be the type of person that would sooner not say anything, and I wonder how helpful that is. I wonder how harmful it is that I'm not saying anything. Just because I don't want somebody to get the wrong idea, I don't want to hurt anybody, I know that they're putting themselves out there. I know as a creator when I'm putting something out there and it's important to me and I want to say, like, maybe I don't necessarily want to offend or hurt anybody, but then I, as a creator, might want to know so I can avoid doing that in the future. It's just hard in general. It's kind of, when it's a touchy subject, I worry. I just don't want to hurt people. That's like my bottom line applying to everything. I never ever want to say something that would hurt anybody, even unintentionally. And when I do that, I get very, very upset.
Yeah, I mean, and I think, you know, a couple of takeaways from what you just said. One is, you know, text communication, like in the comments or, you know, on Tumblr or Twitter, wherever you are, it's really tough, even with like so many smiley faces. You might be like, oh, this person, oh, you know, it really hurts you.
Every color heart emoji that they possibly have, it will still be read terribly.
Yeah, and I think, so an important thing to remember in terms of facilitating a positive experience online, both for yourself and for like everyone else who's participating and seeing that, is to remind yourself that you don't know how that person like was inflecting that question. You don't know where they're coming from. Lauren, your husband actually taught me a very good skill with this. I got a Tumblr message once that really upset me because it just seemed like so misguided, and I shared it with Matt, and he said, well, you know, they're probably just a younger person who like doesn't understand this yet, and they don't know, you know.
He says that to me at least once a day.
Yeah. It's not the best advice, because I think about it now, and now I remember, because, you know, for some reason it was different for me thinking, like, just that, oh, they might not have encountered this yet, they don't understand that they're being, like, offensive in this way. And the other thing that I was going to say was that, as a creator, I think one of the ways that you can create a like happy, productive comment space and not have it be like the ugly comments. YouTube is stereotypes and having these awful comments, but like if you're from Nerd Fighteria, you're like, oh no, comments are wonderful. And I think the way that you can do that is kind of like John and Hank did of, you know, just like state to your community like what your comment section is. Like this is a place where we are going to have productive conversations. And I think, you know, having those questions at the end of videos, not just like, you know, like this or leave an emoji heart in comments, but actually like, what do you think about this? And as a fan, I think all of us in here are both creators and fans, so like when you're in the fan viewer seat, actually replying to those, like Lauren was just saying, you know, sometimes, and you don't always have to, of course, but remember that is part of how you can contribute to it being a positive experience for everyone. Yeah, if you need a mic to the gentleman in blue.
I'd be curious to know how some of you or all of you discovered the power of the video and the comments to create a community. How did that When did you realize that that existed and that you wanted to expand it?
I'm laughing because I was a snob about it at first. To be perfectly honest, it's gonna get real.
Tell us.
So I actually kind of went into YouTube through the Harry Potter fandom, and I had some friends who were like, "You need to listen to Wizard Rock. You need to." And I was like, "That is the stupidest thing I've ever heard." Like, and then I ate my words. Like,
especially
the biggest.
Lauren is a Wizard Rocker, and he has hosted Wizard Rock shows at her house.
It's true. So seriously though, I finally, I hadn't read the books for a long time, and I picked up the sixth book and I started reading it because the movie was about to come out, and I was like, how could I ever have put this down? And just completely fell into it, and then kind of met the HPA, actually, which introduced me to a lot of close friends, including Esther Earle, who was mentioned in some of John Hanks' videos. And so that kind of group introduced me more to Vlogbrothers, and that introduced me to Five Awesome Girls, and I see all these people, and they all looked so close to each other in these videos, especially back in, 2008, 2009, mm-hmm. That I was, 16, 17 at the time, and I wanted that so badly. So I just did it, I guess. I don't know. I've never been the type to, halfway do anything. So I just started hanging out in the comments because I looked up to these people and they seemed cool and they were nerdy in a way that appealed to me that I didn't get to see at home. So yeah, it just felt like something that I was missing from my kind of IRL community, and it felt like the only way I was going to be able to access it was through comments. So went for it, I guess.
I think or as soon as you said that, I was like, oh gosh, thinking about 9 years, trying to think back, when was the first moment I really realized we had something special here? Mm-hmm. And I think it was Five Awesome Girls. I think, while I was filming those videos, I did them all the way through college, and my college experience was not a positive one. I felt very isolated. I felt like nobody understood me, and I just went to the internet. The internet was where I could find people who got me, and so making videos with these girls brought me out of that. I could go and talk to some people I was excited to hear from on my computer after I got done with classes for the day. And I started getting comments from people saying, I'm in college right now and I don't like it, I don't fit in, and I thought I was totally alone. I thought everyone around me is so happy to be here and fits in, I don't. But seeing you and seeing the way that you are, going and finding your community online, even when you can't find it around you, is really inspiring to me. And I still get people saying, you got me through college, because I knew how hard it was for you from watching all those videos, and you've changed my life. And I couldn't, all I was doing, I really, I go back and I watch my videos on Five Awesome Girls, and I'm very sad in every single one of them. You can see it in my eyes. I was dead inside for a long time, and it's all documented, which is a strange phenomenon. But even now, people come up to me and say, you made a difference in my life, and really all I was doing was venting to a platform about what I was going through. And I think that's kind of amazing and powerful. And ever since then, try to cultivate that, try to get that going as much as possible, because I thrive on it, and so do the people that I'm engaging with.
Yeah, I remember I really wasn't involved in the YouTube community or in any really significant capacity, but I remember it was, first product's about 7 years old, and we were about 2 years in. It was in 2010, maybe, or 2009-ish. And I remember that someone sent me a video that John had done called Your Yard is Evil. And it was this video where he just basically talked about the water consumption, particularly the potable water consumption in America to feed grass, which does not feed us, as he articulately points out in the video. And I was like, this man is amazing. I'm in love with this person. And I, as so many, hundreds of thousands of people have done, spent the next 8 hours of my life just I remember going back to that original watching the videos, but I went back to the original one and read all these comments, and I started responding to people who were talking about I wish that there was something I could do to get involved. And I was like, oh my gosh, you guys, we have all these students who are doing these amazing things, people our age. I was 21 at the time. And people started responding, and I was like, oh wow, this is crazy. Like, I said something, and someone said something back. And we started this dialogue, and we were like, how can I get involved? Like, what can I do? And it began this really interesting intersection into this community, and to see, I think it was really interesting for me because, you know, we started in the offline world, and for me to see how quickly the online community responded when we gave them an outlet and said, and it wasn't like it was my channel, it wasn't like it was my video, we said, hey, here's something we're doing, like, you can make an impact on this, like, you can change this, and to see so many people respond so quickly, it was just a really incredible and very sort of special time, so.
Was that a question?
Hey guys, what's up? My question is pretty much, what would you say to people, say, obviously, you know, you guys are talking a lot about 2007, 2008, 2009, when the community was still small and was still very much felt like you were, you know, the weirdos in the back. And now it's, you know, been, a lot of this has become quote-unquote mainstream. John Green is a legitimate celebrity. It's all very weird for people. What would you say to people who are coming into the fandoms and to the communities for the first time and don't really know how to behave and how to act, and what's that one or two guiding principle you would say to them, like, hey, this is what our world is about and this is how you should behave when you interact here?
Yeah, that's a good question that I think everyone's kind of thinking about, like, since the Baltimore Stars was really especially. Well, I mean, you know, one thing that I was gonna say is that I think a lot of this still applies today, in terms of being a smaller creator and still having the same level of engagement. I have a friend who, I think he has maybe 100 subscribers, but the people who comment on his videos are so into it. You know, they start discussions, he can do like challenges and stuff with them, and they're totally interacting in that way. And even like, and then, you know, the bigger YouTubers like Dan and Phil or Connor Franta, they still have that kind of like community and like friendships happening in their comments. So this stuff is definitely still happening, like, on all levels today. I don't know, do any of you have a good idea of, like, what do you do when, like, new people kind of come into these communities and they don't quite get the positive experience that we have developed?
I set an example. I try to lead by example. I try to, at least with audience engagement, even, like, in person at an event like this, if somebody comes up to me and is really excited to see me and they're just kind of squealing and bouncing, I'll ask them, how's your VidCon going? Get like a conversation going. Because that's, I talk to people like I've known them for years on my channel, and when I get in person and they don't really know how to respond to me, that's what I do. And it, right away they start talking to me just like I'm a person. And I think I should be more direct, because I think I have a responsibility as a community leader and as a somebody with some influence, that I really should probably take a more active role in trying to facilitate that, you know, that learning experience. Like, this is how we do things here. This is, we are accepting, we listen to the things that other people say, especially if they have a different viewpoint from us. But in general, I try to, that's the more passive, the way to go about it, is that I just try to live by example and try to set a positive example for the people who are looking up to me, so they kind of know how to behave.
Yeah, I feel like there's so much value in these smaller channels, and I feel like a lot of times when the people first kind of enter the world of YouTube, it's because they know like a select handful of people with 80 bajillion million subscribers, when really, like, if I think about my experiences, I wouldn't be here if it weren't for the channels with, you know, 28 subscribers. Like, we're talking like small. So, I mean, and that's where the learning happens, I think, in a lot of ways, just because, like you were saying, it is harder to communicate with creators now that they do have such large audiences. And I feel like in some ways, watching a video by a smaller creator and having the opportunity to interact with them, like you were saying, it does show you that it can be just like a regular interaction. Like, it doesn't have to be this like completely different beast from interacting with different parts of the internet. So
creators aren't real.
That is, you know, I mean, that is a big thing. We don't need to say it in here with you guys, but yeah, that's definitely, I was saying that on the news.
Well, it's funny because Lauren actually said, like, I'm a person, and it's like,
yeah.
That's the thing.
Treat other people like they want to be treated, and also, you know, like they're actual human beings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm both
good tip to have. People are people.
I think we have time to take one last question. question, then we'll do some final thoughts. Okay. Oh, I hate having to pick people and multiple people. Someone else choose.
Okay, I'm bad at this too.
Okay, you go ahead right here. Yeah.
So, within the community, you know how you get really bad comments. Sometimes people are really rude and it hurts your feelings. You say you have that one person offline that you talk to and you communicate with makes you feel better about it. What do you guys personally do when, you know, you're trying to find somebody offline, you're trying to, you know, make yourself feel better and that person goes, well, it's just an online person. You don't know who they are. Why do you care what they think? How do you respond to that? How do you get through that?
It's interesting because, I mean, sometimes I have to wonder why I do care in the first place. So, like, in some ways, their question, like, makes you stop for a second and go, "What? Well, I don't know, but, I mean, I do care." So, like, it is hard.
Yeah, I mean, I encountered a lot of that when I was volunteering with the Harry Potter Alliance before it became my job. And now that it's a job, I guess people like think it's legitimate and they understand it more. But I would always get people like, you know, why are you wasting your time with that? Like, it's just a fan club and, you know, making awful assumptions like that. And like, yeah, it's just online. Like, why do you care? And that did bother me a lot. Then I would find someone else to vent to, usually. so that is one piece of advice. And I think, you know, Katie's right. It is a good check to be like, you know, why do I care? But you do because it is still an actual emotion that you're feeling, and it is a place that you are probably using as a safe space and a place of creation or expression. And so I guess reminding yourself of that, and you know, so you had a hater and then you encountered another hater.
Yeah, I mean, not to be like too combative a response, but I would say that maybe that's a crappy friend. Like, the fact is you care.
Yeah.
And like, they don't need to question why you care. The reality is like, that's what you're feeling and you care. And so I would say like, find someone else. Like, yeah.
I actually was going to say something very similar, which is that I've noticed over the last few years, I have replaced all of the people in my life who did not respect or understand what I do because I didn't relate to them anymore. They didn't understand. And I'm very lucky that because I've been so involved in this community, I've made a lot of friends who are really supportive, who do understand it, and who actually exist in the community. And so having those people to go to when something goes wrong and to have them, to know that they truly get it, has made my life a lot better. And yeah.
Make a lot of friends this weekend. And
yeah.
Reach out to them.
The fact that matters is that you deserve to be respected in every avenue of your life, and you shouldn't have to validate it.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah. That is an amazing note to end on. I just want to really quick, in our last minute or so, let's go down the line and just let everyone know what's next in your projects and where everyone can find you to talk about this weekend.
So Uplift just launched a new video series called Engage by Uplift. You can find us on youtube.com/uplifttogether. We do have a booth as well. We're booth number 617. We'll have a lot of people hanging out there. It's a lot of fun. We also just launched our website. And we're working on launching some awesome resources in the future too. But really, this video series, guys, I'm really excited to have some videos on sexual violence prevention that are accessible to everyone, whether and not just, you know, college freshmen going through orientation. So please, if you have any questions about it, I'd love to talk to you guys about it.
Harry Potter Alliance, what were we saying? Oh yeah, what's up next? Okay, we're working on, I came up with questions. So we're doing two campaigns right now. One is called Positive Fandom, and it's about encouraging a healthy fandom experience. You can go to positivefandom.com or .org, .com. Yeah, positivefandom.com. We put together some guidelines that learn more about it from there. We're also doing a fair use of copyright campaign with Fanworks that I kind of mentioned before. We've got info about that at our booth, which is booth 1003. So you can come check us out later. Yeah.
Awesome. So many things happening. We're about to relaunch our school tour in the fall. So if you're in middle school, high school, college, and there's products not in your school, like, we'll come for free. We don't charge anything. We just want to come speak to your students, educate about the water crisis. So hopefully this year we're on track for just over 400 school stops, which would be amazing. So that's crazy. Also, Connor's Connor's birthday is coming up again, so Connor Prenta is giving his birthday again to raise money, so that'll be awesome coming up in about a month. And we have a dump tank in the expo hall where we're dumping YouTubers every hour on the hour to raise money for charity, to build wells. All the money goes to build water projects, so come, I forget who's in there next, but come check it out. It's like 5:15, I think is the number, and there's project.org.
Well, given that VidCon has been so fun and so inspiring, I'm really excited to go home and make more videos. So that's what I'm going to be doing. Definitely check out my channel. You can either search for just Lauren Fairweather, or you can go to youtube.com/LaurenFairweather. And yeah, just come check me out, say hello, leave me interesting comments, let's have a discussion, and yeah.
And just one quick note, I think the next panel needs to come here, so if you want to talk and everything, we'll go out in the hallway for that. But thank you all for your awesome thoughts and questions.